Bienvenue, good afternoon. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to welcome you to the very first panel of the Keep It On Summit, which is a special insider track at RightsCon Brussels. Over the course of the next few days, we'll explore different facets of internet shutdowns with the world's leading experts. Many of you are sitting right here in the room today, and we encourage you to participate, ask questions, get involved, disagree, come up with new ideas. That's the spirit of RightsCon, and we really welcome that. But to start us off, I'd like to lay a quick baseline to get us started. We don't need to argue over a definition of what an internet shutdown is. Exactly 1 year ago, a group of technologists, lawyers, and activists came up with a definition of internet shutdowns, and I'll read it here today. An internet shutdown is an intentional disruption of internet or electronic communications, rendering them inaccessible or effectively unusable for a specific population or within a location, often to exert control over the flow of information. The last part is really important. The definition could probably be improved, but the summit is not really meant to be a definitional exercise. We're here to move towards outcomes. We don't need to argue about whether shutdowns have occurred. They have. And an absolute minimum of about 50 were recorded last year in Africa, Asia, the Americas, and even Europe. They've occurred during elections, school exams, protests, and because of court judgments. We don't need to argue about whether violence thrives under internet shutdowns. This has been proven in numerous disruptions over the past years, during which peaceful protesters have been slaughtered with impunity, leading to gross human rights violations. We also don't need to argue about whether shutdowns impact the economy. We know that they do, and two path-breaking studies from the Brookings Institution and the Global Network Initiative, sponsored by Facebook, have effectively made the case. Brookings estimates that $2.4 billion was drained from the economy last year. It's now a question of degree. We don't need to argue about whether people are doing anything to fight internet shutdowns. We officially launched the Keep It On campaign to fight internet shutdowns last year, and it has grown to nearly 124 organizations from 51 countries. We don't need to argue about whether anything has changed. The UN Human Rights Council spoke out by unequivocally condemning internet shutdowns. The African Commission on Human and People's Rights has spoken out. The Global Network Initiative, which is a collection of companies, academics, investors, and telecommunications companies, has spoken out. Governments have spoken out. And many more stakeholders will do so this week at RightsCon. We've even partnered with Lush Cosmetics to sell a bath product to raise awareness about internet shutdowns in some 1,000 stores in almost 40 countries. The funds raised by that product will go towards supporting digital rights around the world. But as you'll hear today, there's a lot that we don't know. These challenges range from detection, to coordination, to implementation, to documentation, and circumvention. Fighting internet shutdowns is a moonshot problem, but there are multiple moons and different trajectories to get there. Solutions depend on stakeholders lending their generosity, resources, and expertise to resolve the problem. To put this in perspective, there are three ongoing shutdowns right now in Pakistan, Bahrain, and Cameroon. We're going to try to address these challenges at the Keep It On Summit with the hope to leave on Friday with real solutions and commitments to action. We'd like to thank our sponsors, AnchorFree and Siphon, who have generously supported the summit. And thank you to my colleagues Peter Misek, Gustav Bjorksten, and Anchi Lee in particular for helping to create the program. With that, I'll turn to our panelists to discuss everything we know about internet shutdowns. There's plenty left to talk about. Thank you.
Deji. Okay, so according to the norm, as I understand it, I'm not supposed to introduce the panel. The panelists are encouraged to identify themselves, which leaves me with not much of a role at all, other than to say, I'm Ron Deibert, I'm director of the Citizen Lab, and I'm glad to be here. I will say, many years ago when the Open Net Initiative project, some of you might remember, was in the midst of just getting going, and we were putting together our first edited volume. Rebecca, I think you had a chapter in Access Denied. And at that time, internet shutdowns were very rare. And we realized, even though they're rare, they're likely to become more common. And we coined a phrase, just-in-time blocking, to capture this idea that there may be an incentive for governments to shut off or block services around key moments in time, because that's when information has most strategic value. And there are all sorts of other reasons as well, having to do with plausible deniability. In a lot of the countries we're talking about, it's not uncommon for the internet to have problems. And so people can just say, you know, maybe it's something to do with the internet, it's not us. And so to see not only the number of these cases just explode, 50 as you're saying over the last year, it's remarkable to me. But also on the other side, to see Keep It On Summit, to see the research that's going on here is really encouraging to me. And it certainly gives me hope that we can do something about it. So without further ado, I'm gonna turn it over to whoever on the self-organizing panel wants to first identify themselves and proceed.
So I'm, well, I don't mind going first. So self-identification, I'm Raman Chima. I head Access's global public policy team. I also serve as a trustee with the Internet Freedom Foundation, which is India's net neutrality and internet freedoms campaign group. And again, it's just fantastic to see everyone here. And I agree with Ron. I remember when the first report came out from the Open Net Initiative, people were saying that shutdowns were rare. I think many of us at that time talked about the Egypt shutdown when it happened as one massive egregious example of an entire country going offline. You saw economic data at that point as well. The OECD put out a fairly fantastic study just talking about the economic consequences to Egypt's industry when the shutdown happened. But I think what's much more interesting, as you know, Deji's mentioned, is that every few months we're seeing more and more countries do shutdowns, including people for whom shutdowns perhaps would not seem to be the new normal. I'm an Indian by citizenship. I'm based in India most of the time. Some of you who were at RightsCon 2 years ago may remember there was a fantastic celebration because the Indian Supreme Court, in fact, had passed a judgment exactly, which came out exactly as RightsCon day two happened. We timed it all. But we said that free speech in India applies online. Citizens require strong, fantastic protection. And it's a funny moment where 2 years since then, India is now tied with Iraq, according to the Brookings report and with others, in terms of the highest number of internet shutdowns in the world. It has the world's second largest internet user base. It's the most online democracy there, but there are massive numbers of shutdowns. And you know, you could argue, isn't that incongruous? And it's not. Because one of the challenges people say is just-in-time blocking. And when it's just-in-time blocking, it often comes below the radar. There's not enough public discussion on governments taking a clear step against shutdowns. There are even questions about whose job it is. In large federal democracies, not just India, but many others, sometimes they say, look, it's not the central government's fault, it's not the federal government's fault. State agencies, provincial authorities, local police, they're blocking it. They know what's better for law and order. Don't come and block, you know, bug federal ministers on this. Which is a challenge, right? Who is responsible for blocking? Very often these internet shutdowns happen under emergency police powers. It may not be even an issue the telecommunications minister officially takes responsibility for, but it might be the police saying, we need to prevent a riot, we need to prevent other circumstances from occurring. They're going to issue a blocking order, or you know, my favorite anecdote is they block by switching off power to a cell phone base station that just happens to serve perhaps half the city. Now, the reality is we need to bring these discussions out publicly, which is why the Keep It On campaign, the first part of it has been generating discussion, generating debate. And it's then going towards the costs of it, and then it's going towards taking action. And now a lot of this is happening simultaneously. I think, Ron, you mentioned about the economic costs of shutdowns, fantastic reports that are out. I know many other people are now working on the social consequences of shutdowns, societal. What impact does it have on individual people? How does it affect crisis response? Many people who may work in the tech community in terms of crisis response are aware that a lot of hacking, for example, geo-hacking efforts happen through quick online collaboration, Twitter, Ushahidi, and other platforms like that. If you have a shutdown, you can't access those. That's a cost we need to document, because very often the Minister for Security often talks to the Minister for Emergency Response, and they're now in a situation where they don't know what's happening. I'll just like mention, you know, for example, there's been fantastic work that the Digital Empowerment Foundation in India is doing around the social consequences of shutdowns. Many other people are working on that as well, and we need to look at that. But it's a discussion which is not separate from taking action and what's what you're probably going to look up there. Many groups in India have been trying to make a public discussion around internet shutdowns, what is happening, the fact that the union government has to take responsibility. The position from the union governments has been that, no, police agencies across the country are shutting down the internet. It's not our fault. Although telecommunications is a constitutional subject which the center or the federal government should be in charge of. Now, the reality, of course, as you know, is that unless you mainstream a campaign, people don't take you seriously. And that's one effort that that Keep It On campaigners in India have been doing, some great, fantastic work from the Source of Freedom Law Center in India, and then a moment to try and make it really mainstream, which I'll explain now, this little screen grab behind me. This is from India's most famous online comedy group, a group called AIB. Imagine John Oliver, but slightly not safe for work. They, besides being on YouTube and being very popular, they also have a show that comes on an Indian streaming platform, Hotstar. For some of you who follow net neutrality campaigning, they're the people responsible for 1.2 million people writing to the Indian telecom regulator, and they work very closely with the activism community. They came when they saw shutdowns happening and said, what can we do? Can we talk about this? This is an important issue. They collaborated with the Internet Freedom Foundation, of which Kiran is sitting there in the front row. Kiran, put your hand up. There, Kiran. And said, we want to make this issue mainstream. We want to find out what's happening. And they took the research of fantastic academics and experts. They cited to work from the Software Freedom Law Center India, the Center for Communication Governance, legal academics, and they put it out saying that this is happening. You should take a decision on this. Or at least, let's ask the Indian Prime Minister to indicate what their position is and put that out there. So that's something that's come out. It released now, I think, barely 2 weeks ago. It's already 15,000 plus signatures. 100 organizations have signed up online. And this generates a public moment. Now the question is, we have the public discussion. Hopefully this becomes an even more mainstream issue. What should happen next? And I'd like the thing I'd probably leave with the panel is the fact what we should prevent is the normalization of shutdowns. Because what really the debate is about the fact that shutdowns may occur, but the fact that it's being normalized as standard operating procedure from government, from police agencies across the world, that is disturbing. Even government's disturbed by it. I can share an anecdote. I have a family friend who's in the police services in India. And he said, yeah, I shut down the internet sometimes. I don't think it's okay. I am troubled by what my colleagues are doing. They want to shut it down for anything, without any process, without any accountability on it. And that's something that's there. So I'd venture that that's something perhaps we should talk about. How do we prevent the normalization of shutdowns? And what's required further from our community to actually be able to take effective action on this? This is self-organized, so who takes it next?
Great, thank you very much. Over to you, Julie.
Well, since I'm sitting right next to you, I'll just take the mic, thank you. Speaking to respond to your question, I will put... Sorry, not everybody knows me? How is this possible? Sorry, I'm Julie Owono from Internet Sans Frontières, so Internet Without Borders, and we're a member of the Keep It On coalition as well, and we've been working a lot on internet shutdowns in Africa very recently. So the last case is Cameroon, which I talked about a bit earlier today. So to respond to your question, how to avoid these shutdowns to become normal, I'll take the example of what's worked, although internet is not back, but I mean, what's worked in the narrative. A lot of countries in Africa, and I'm sure elsewhere, especially in the global south, are really into this discourse of saying that digital economy is great, especially when we are transitioning from commodity-based economies to digital ones. So they are very positive officially in their discourse about the digital world. But at the same time, they are shutting down the internet, many of them. A country like Cameroon, for instance, is proud of itself, proud to say that it has a very vibrant tech community, but at the same time, it shut down the internet to that community. So what's really worked, and I think what could really stop this from being the new normal, is to show the counterproductive productiveness and contradictory I mean, this is totally contradictory to say that you want the digital economy, but you don't want, I mean, you want to shut down the internet whenever you feel like. So we've argued a lot on the economic aspect of the shutdown in Cameroon. It has already cost, up to the 60th day, it has cost $2.69 million. So it might seem nothing, but for a country like Cameroon, which is negotiating with the IMF, multiple loans because of the commodity prices crash of the past years, it has been in a huge crisis. Plus, we have Boko Haram, so we have to invest a lot on preventing terrorism to spread throughout the country. So obviously, economy is very, I mean, these are tough times economically. So when we argue that the country is facing a tough time, but at the same time, you are preventing people to create wealth, to create, to make the economy be lively again, it's a problem. And it to some extent, the discourse at least has opened the minds of those who were among the citizens who didn't see it as being totally wrong, especially in Cameroon. There is the digital divide, but also the language divide, because internet is cut only in English-speaking regions. So for a lot of Francophones didn't see where the problem was. I mean, you just need to cross the border to go to find internet connection. So once we put out the economic aspect, it woke up citizens, but it also woke up big companies, internet companies specifically, who are looking to these markets. And well, how can you invest in a market where you could lose twice in a month what you have invested? So it doesn't make any sense economically. And this is something really that, in my opinion, should be fostered, of course, along with the human rights, because the economic liberties go along with liberal societies where human rights are a reality. But what we've seen is that since we've put out this economic aspect, it has at least woke up some partners which were very silent, unfortunately, up to now. And also one thing that I wanted to point out is there is an index, I forget the precise name, but which is put out each year by the World Economic Forum, which assesses the receptivity of a country to the internet society. I don't remember the name, I'm sorry. But it ranks countries depending on how receptive the country is to digital service, to digital economy. And I think there is a space there to harness, to show that, okay, if you cut the internet, how receptive is your country? How can you build trust of investors in the digital economy if your country is not receptive due to internet shutdown? So these are areas that could be harnessed in order to not make this become the new normal. And the other very important part of the advocacy and the discourse that should be put out is to bring in international partners, but government partners. And that's what we did very recently, along with other fellow members of some of the members of the Keep It On Coalition, including Access Now, and other personalities. We just sent this, it's in French. So it's an open letter to French presidential candidates, so you know there will be an election in a bit less than when is it?
A couple of weeks,
yeah, right, less than a month. So we put out this letter calling them to take a stand on this issue of internet shutdowns. Why we did so? A lot of people complain that it's colonialism. It could be perceived this way, but really it's beyond that. Like Edward Snowden tweeted, if it happens in Cameroon, it could happen here. So if French presidential candidates take a stand against what's happening in Cameroon, it means that they won't do it here. Or if they consider doing it at some point, they will think twice because they took a stand against it a few months ago or a few years ago. So these are some of the building up the economic discourse, of course, but also pressuring and shaming and naming from the international community those who resort to such radical measures. So yes, these are some of the ideas.
Okay, thank you, Julie. Doug, do you want to go next?
Sorry.
Yeah, I'll go next. So hello, everybody. My name is Doug Madory. I'm the director of internet analysis at Dyn. And I am, Dyn is a, for those of you who don't know, is a major, is one of the world's major DNS service providers. And what I do, I'm a computer scientist by trade. And we aren't a an advocacy organization. We're an internet business. Yeah, but I, over the last 5 or 6 years, have been writing up a technical analysis of internet shutdowns starting back in January 2011. Thank you. When with the Egyptian shutdown and the subsequent other Arab Spring shutdowns, and that's kind of been, you know, I write quite a bit about do these technical analysis of just events in general of global internet infrastructure, and they typically fall into a couple different categories. One's in BGP routing security. This is Border Gateway Protocols. It's kind of the nuts and bolts of how the internet works. That's for the more technical crowd. And then the other category are some of these geopolitical events where these days there isn't a global geopolitical event that doesn't have some sort of internet component in it anymore. And so what we try to bring to the table is some dispassionate technical analysis that hopefully informs discourse, that we have just some hard facts that people can rely on to then go and advocate or go and analyze. But it starts with some technical expertise to just confirm precisely what's happening and how do we know what's happening in any given country. Maybe I'll just mention a couple things in the past year or so that we've touched on. So I see, you know, we've written, like I said, quite a bit about shutdowns. And, you know, last summer there was stuff going on in Gabon where you had about a 4-day complete blackout followed by almost a month of nightly 12-hour internet curfews, kind of something I hadn't seen before. I don't think anybody had seen that before. and so we were kind of on that quite a bit, kind of tweeting it out. And then I've got, I do a lot of communication with the press as well, where I will kind of pass this on to the tech press and try to give them the details that they may need to run a story. It was, you know, you touched on normalization of blackouts being a concern, and I have that concern too as somebody who kind of reports it, and I'm one of the go-to people that reporters will go and ask to confirm a story, and there is a little bit of a banality these days of especially a country that's off the radar like Gabon was. I was kind of surprised that this was such a hard sell, you know, just in the back channel. And actually, I got CNN, BuzzFeed, and Motherboard Vice, to their credit, published stories about what was going on there, partly because I knew the reporters, I had long relationships with them, and I said, you know, this is a good story to cover. And so that's, I guess that's how we're advocates. But otherwise, I also feel it's important for us to refute incorrect stories. So we've had in the last year a few things that we've been involved in. Like one just happened a couple weeks ago where there was a submarine cable cut providing service into Madagascar. This submarine cable goes up and down East Africa. And at one point they had to take the entire cable down to do the repairs. Well, the timing of the repairs couldn't have been worse because it was about like an hour or so prior to the national debate that was going to be televised in Mogadishu. So there's an election going on there. It's a very contentious thing. And so the national internet goes out right before the debate begins and people freak out. And so I kind of follow this on Twitter. I follow people reporting on these things, and I was like, and I went and looked, and I saw, you know, up and down the entire region, it all went down at the same time. So that can't be possibly just a Mogadishu specific. And so then I knew the guys from the submarine cable company from prior work, and tried to advocate that they put out some sort of public release just to let people know what happened. And then I've got contacts like Deji at Access Now just to let them know that I'm pretty sure this is a submarine cable maintenance event versus a government shutdown. So I feel very strongly that we'd be accurate at what is or isn't government suppression, so that when we have it right, it's verified. And then there was also a case in Liberia that was widely reported that the country had gone completely offline due to a DDoS attack. It turned out that was incorrect. I didn't have any evidence of this. I started getting reports to confirm the story, and I didn't have anything. I have a good relationship with David Belson, who's kind of like my counterpart at Akamai. It's the biggest CDN in the world, so I called him up and I was like, "Are you seeing this?" And we were comparing notes. Neither of us saw anything, so we put out try to put out some information refuting that story as well. Of course, from doing this for a number of years, I know that while an outage may get some coverage, restorations, nobody cares. And refuting corrections, there's no market for corrections. And so when we're doing this, we're just doing it just because it's just the right thing to do. There's not going to be any PR benefit from issuing a correction. It's just what needs to be done. But anyway, I could tell lots of stories along those lines, but I'll let Rebecca do her thing.
Sure. Just before we turn to Rebecca, I think I read one of your reports about high school exams as a
kind of an unexpected major subcategory of internet shutdowns. It's pretty strange. So I think two summers ago, let's see, what year is it? It's 2015, we first saw this happening in Iraq, where they would take the national backbone down. I saw this happening, it was like every other day for a week or so, and I've got pretty good sources in Iraq. I've got a senior Iraqi government official that's a good ally there that can kind of give me some inside information. Aside from, I've got the computer science chops, I've got the data to figure something out, but at the end of the day, sometimes you just need somebody who's there, who can tell you the context then. So that started in 2015, and then it started up again last year, where there was three sessions for students who missed exams, and they would have make up exams and take the internet down again. And it started a trend. It started to happen in Africa as well. So this is becoming an unexpected, kind of an odd thing. We saw this in Syria as well last summer, and following people's tweets about these events. Initially, people were like, "All right, this is government, oppression for sure." This is I was like, these timings are kind of odd. It's like 5 a.m. to 8 a.m. What would be the strategic value of this? Maybe I'm missing something. And so then Syria too, I was able to secure some good sources in Syria that could give me, copies of the government orders taking this down. And you're like, "Wow, this really is about exams." It is hard to get your mind around. So let me just briefly, and I'll let Rebecca do her pitch here in a minute. So this is why this is happening, at least in Iraq. Public education, there are these placing exams at sixth grade, and if you don't score high enough, that's the end of your public education. And being a young person in Iraq, I think you've got, the odds are stacked against you to begin with. And if you can't score high enough and you're booted out of public education, the future's pretty bleak at that point. And so I think parents, when there's high stakes, there's high incentives to cheat. And so what was happening in a number of these countries is that as soon as the exams were getting physically distributed around the country, people would be taking pictures of them and putting them on social media and solving all the problems. And by the time students sat to take the exam, some portion of them would have already memorized all the answers or have seen all the questions. And so the entire exams would get compromised. And it is kind of amazing in a country like Iraq with all that's going on with ISIS and there's issues with corruption, there's all kinds of major, major issues, that this was the one that they took such an extreme measure on. But yeah, so they shake down the national backbone while they physically distribute the exams. And then once the exams begin, they take down mobile data service, but they restore the backbone. And that's... I thought that was going to go away, but that seems like that's...
If they keep doing that, what will happen is they'll generate old school forms of cheating like I used to do. You just like write
crib notes on your hand. They're coming back.
Yeah. I could make money teaching that, believe me, from East Vancouver. Rebecca, over to you.
Well, thanks so much, Ron. And I just want to commend Access for doing this Keep It On Summit and really calling attention to these issues. It's just hearing from people about kind of specifically what's happening in specific places is just really drives it home. So what I'm going to talk about, and we can show, I have just a few slides just to help explain what we're looking at here. I run a project called Ranking Digital Rights, and we rank 22 companies selected from across the world, 12 internet and mobile companies, and 10 telecommunications companies that are distributed across the world. And I think pretty soon we'll have a slide with sort of the map that shows the distribution of the companies. And we examine these companies according to 35 different indicators. So we're asking, so here's the map with the distribution of companies that we're looking at here. And we're gonna have a session at 2:30 where we talk about the whole index. So I'm just going to talk about one question we're asking about network shutdowns. So that's the distribution of companies. And this, again, I'll go into more detail about the whole index at 2:30 at our session. And that's just kind of an overview that's gonna be hard for you to see, that we have 10 different telcos we look at, and you'll see more granularly in a minute, and then some internet companies. And we're asking 35 different questions in three different categories, sort of one category on their governance, one category related to freedom of expression, and one category related to privacy. And within the freedom of the expression category, we have one question that asks about network shutdowns. So let me see. And I'm gonna just jump here because this shows kind of granularly the companies we're looking at, and then I'll explain kind of what we're looking at for this question. But we're looking for companies' disclosure about their policies in dealing with network shutdowns. And the highest scoring two companies only got 38% out of 100 possible points on this indicator, and it went down from there. I'll explain a little bit more about what we were asking. So the indicator is looking to see, and we're evaluating companies on their commitments and disclosures. So the indicator is looking to see whether the company clearly explains the circumstances under which it may shut down or restrict access to the network or to specific protocol services or applications on the network. And so then we have several sub-questions that we're looking at that then kind of create the possible 100%. So the first thing we're looking at, and we consulted with Access actually on this indicator and a number of other people who are here at the conference today, experts on these things. Does the company clearly explain the reasons it may shut down service to a particular area or group of users? Does the company clearly explain why it may restrict access to specific applications or protocols in a particular area or to a specific group of users? Does the company clearly explain its process for responding to requests, or in many countries, demands, to shut down a network or restrict access to a service? So does it disclose anything about whether it even has a process for examining requests? Does the company commit to push back on requests to shut down a network or restrict access to a service? So if the company is getting requests that aren't actually lawful, that are just kind of informal and have no actual basis in law, does the company have a policy internally for its executives to question that, to call up a lawyer and see, do we actually need to honor this request? Can anything legally be done to us if we refuse? Does the company have a policy or process around that? Does it clearly disclose that it notifies users in whatever way it can, at whatever point it can? Obviously, if you shut down the network, it's kind of hard to communicate directly at that time, but there are ways to, get word out sooner or later through international media and so on about what's happened. Does the company list the number of network shutdown requests it receives? So is it doing transparency reporting about network shutdown demands? Does it clearly identify the specific legal authority that is making the requests? And does the company list the number of requests with which it complied? So again, transparency reporting around the requests. And so with our results, you'll see that no company even met 50% of what we were looking for. Two companies met what ended up being 38% of what we were looking for. Telefonica was the only company that disclosed the number of requests it was receiving. But no company disclosed the number of requests it's actually complied with, so the percentage that it complies with versus the number of requests. Vodafone was the only company that committed to challenge overbroad requests. So only one company actually had a public commitment in that regard. And then we have, three companies with 13%, four companies with 6%, and one company with 0%. You can read, so I won't go too
far down the naming and shaming route, but you can read. And I would point out that there are four companies in this list that are members of the Telecommunications Industry Dialogue, three of which joined the Global Network Initiative yesterday. And two of them are at the top, and then the other two red arrows are the other two industry dialogue companies. AT&T did not join Global Network Initiative. So even among companies that actually have pretty strong commitments to respect users' rights, there's a lot of work to be done around basic transparency. Now, just to recognize, there are some challenges that companies face when it comes to licensing agreements with governments that may prevent them from disclosing a lot of this information. And we don't give the companies a break for whether part of their low score is due to governments preventing them from disclosing. We just kind of report the facts of what they do and do not do. And so I think this points to an opportunity for companies and the advocacy community to work together to reform laws so that companies can maximize transparency around these questions. So every sub-question within this indicator, companies should be able to legally to do this. You know, unless there's a really clear national security case that is publicly acceptable, public safety national security case, why that might be not, why there may be reasons not to disclose. But there isn't even enough public discussion about what those cases are. So we have a lot of work to do just around transparency. I think potentially some low-hanging fruit. I mean, I think there's a lot of opportunity to display commitments and actions that are being taken a lot more than is currently the case.
So. Rebecca, could I ask you a question?
Sure.
So on this list here, there's almost all of them are companies that operate in more than 10 countries,
exactly.
Like some of these are in
a lot of
places.
Yeah, we chose the companies kind of for that reason,
okay.
Because they have big global footprints.
How does that affect it? Because it seems like every market is going to
sure.
have different
Every market has
issues.
Different laws, right. So with our methodology, and we'll go into this a bit more in our other session, we looked at the company's global group level commitments and disclosures, and we looked at their home country operating company practices and policies. So this is just what's happening in the home country. So, and the transparency and commitments at the global group level. So it's possible that you may see different percentages or lower percentages regarding a company's operations in a, let's say Telefonica in a specific Latin American market, or Vodafone in, Egypt or something. And so one of the things we're welcoming people to do is to kind of take the questions and look at more specific operating companies around the world to get a more granular sense. But this is kind of, even in the home country, this is the level of transparency we're seeing.
Well, thank you for that, Rebecca. And it's great to see some data being brought to bear on all of this between what you're doing and what Doug does on a regular basis. So now I'd like to invite comments, questions from the audience. Deji's got a mic and he's going to be walking around. So if you raise your hand and signal him back there, he will bring it around to. Where can you get a cup?
Rankingdigitalrights.org. Rankingdigitalrights.org. If you go to the website and you click on Corporate Accountability Index, you'll get our 2017 data. There's a link that says download. You can download all the raw data, and you can also play around with visualizations of every indicator and every sub-question and so on. So it's all there, and the methodology is also there, so you can also hack the methodology if you want to kind of take some of the questions and apply them in some places and delete some of the other questions or whatever.
Okay, so we got a question.
Thank you. My name is Grace from Kenya. I'm very interested in the whole discussion about the private sector or the companies, and I'm just wondering, especially those who work in Africa, whether you've had a chance to see the license agreements between the corporates and the regulators. And because sometimes I just wonder, what is the particular thing in the license agreement that is so, that really has to be obeyed, that the companies just have to respond to the regulator when they are told to shut down the internet?
That's a great question. So the contracts between the companies?
I can take a shot at that. So most of them have a standard form, you know, I won't say standard form, they are standard forms. The ITU proposes some of the GSMA and other industry groups have also put out model formats to use, but the general process is they say comply with any directions issued by the licensor, which can be very broad. Most countries then can sometimes quote specific laws saying under the say Telecommunications Act, Telegraph Acts, et cetera, et cetera. But that licensor thing is the main piece. Any directions from the licensor, and you speak to most telecom industry executives, at least at the country level, they say that is the most important thing because that is defined by the government. In some countries, they may have an independent regulator or even a semi-independent regulator, which might be, you can challenge that. But in reality, most telcos would be, there are very few who I know are willing to go to that level. So any direction, they have to comply with. Those directions might be specific network disruption orders as well. Some countries have more defined terminology, but most of the time is just comply with any direction sent to them. In reality, that can sometimes not even be a direction from the licensor. For example, in India and even other parts of Asia, very often it's the telecom department is told the local police want to do something, so they will call up the telco, say, you're going to get a call from XYZ person, you comply with that. Otherwise, we will send you a direction from the capital and you don't want that.
Yeah, and I just want to invite people to attend on day three. We have a session devoted to licensing. We want to improve those licenses, come up with a model license that we think would be important and that would be would help push back against internet shutdowns.
That's really, really great to hear. Any other panelists want to talk more on that subject?
I might just throw one thing in. You know, in some of these outages that I've reported on, I often get questions of, Google or Facebook fly their blimp in to Gabon and just start broadcasting internet down and just go around the block. And let's assume all the technical details were ironed out on that and it could be done. At the end of the day, you do have a sovereign country that's governed by a sovereign government that issues licenses to telecoms. You can't have an unlicensed telecommunication service provider.
Shoot the blimp down.
Yeah, I don't know what they'll do. Maybe they'll blow it away. You can't be an unlicensed telecom operator. You have to have an agreement with the government, and so then that goes back to the government. If the government wants to do something bad, that's a hard thing to get around. And that's why this is a tricky problem.
So, and there's one up here later. Yep.
Thank you very much, Nicolas Hedler at the Internet Society. We very much share the concerns on the panel that restrictions to internet access are becoming the new normal. We actually just joined the Keep It On coalition today, and we just launched a paper on internet content blocking. Thank you. One question I had for the panel, you mentioned the fact that shutdowns seem to be in contradiction with a lot of the economic and digital economy commitments that a lot of countries have made. I was wondering if you thought that groups like the IMF, the World Bank, do you think could they have any influence on those countries? Would it be productive for them to step in and mention shutdowns as part of that discourse?
Absolutely. I will give a very good example, which is Cameroon, where there is an internet shutdown. And at the moment, the World Bank there is a bit of disagreement between the government and the World Bank on the issue of how the telco market is managed in Cameroon. So to be more specific, there is a public operator who basically, governs the sector. I mean, it's supposed to be a competitive market, but actually it's not because the public operator has so much privileges, I would even call them. And so the World Bank is actually calling on the government to dismantle the public operator, or at least to open it. So obviously they do have to also to have a say on the issue of the shutdowns, because they are economic and financial partners of these countries. I was mentioning also Cameroon, which is facing a lot of economic issues and financial issues, and which is asking loans from the IMF. And usually the IMF asks from the state to prove that it has done some efforts to, you know, to have a more stable economy. So obviously if you include in the discussion the issue of what are the ways you found to get more money for the country, and if you shut the internet, obviously you've lost money, and we've read reports about it, and it's bad. So I think it would change a lot of things, actually. Taking once again the example of Cameroon, I know that international economic and financial partners have are important for our country. So it could be a way forward, indeed.
We call these structural internet adjustment programs.
And I was just going to mention that the World Development Report last year put out data on the internet's economic impact and the social benefits of the internet as well. That was actually also defining many governments for the first time looked at that when the World Bank put it out. It's important to keep revisiting that and to be able to stress that this is a critical issue that heads of state and the ministers of finance and economies need to look at, because otherwise it's walled off and they say, talk to the home affairs guy, the security guy, maybe talk to the telecom guy, don't talk to me. That has to come up. And I just, you know, venture that in April there'll be the meetings of the bank again there in DC. Peter Mysek from Access Now, in fact, will be engaging with that and encourage others who are interested to particularly communicate to the bank and the economist teams there and the telecom specialists that this should be an issue on their agenda, because while they've talked about it, they're not gone in depth, and we certainly can do more there.
Doug or Rebecca, you want to pick up on that?
Yeah, I mean, definitely the investment vector, whether it's World Bank or kind of government aid vector. You know, some of the governments give development aid, you know, DFID and, you know, the Swedes and so on give development aid across the developing world. And when they're investing in ICT projects, are they asking any questions about that? Are they putting any conditions on it? But also private investment as well, you know, what kinds of conditions and questions are being included in these discussions, and we need a lot more awareness on that, and an understanding of sort of the economic risk that everybody's taking on if they're not asking those questions up front.
Yeah. Hello, my name is Sekou, originally from West Africa, the Gambia, and just recently in December we experienced an internet shutdown 48 hours going into our presidential elections. Now, two things were mentioned that I want to comment on based on experience. Telco companies and ISPs providers. Shutting down the internet completely is different from shutting down certain applications like Viber, the voice over IP application, the WhatsApps. And I want to categorically make it clear that the telcos are not completely innocent in this. When you shut down those applications and people are forced to use VPNs like Firefox, now the data rates is double up. So instead of you having probably like a $50 credit that can last you a week, it will last you probably less than 24 hours because you're using other VPNs to connect to their network. So they are not completely innocent in this. And I've done my research. I'm yet to find a single telco company or IPS that sues the government, that forces them to do these things. Why are they not doing it? Because at the end of the day, the telecommunication, like any other industry, is a business. If I'm losing money, I want to know why I'm losing money and who's going to pay for that. Mm-hmm. And they are not helping. So more pressure needs to be put on there. But another challenge that we experienced as we experienced the internet shutdown in the Gambia, it's hard to kind of convince people that shutting down your communication rights is a human right abuse. Mm-hmm. My 55-year-old mom, who did not go to school, when the internet came back up and I called her, her response was, thank God our president gifted us the internet again. She said gift. And we must make this thing clear. And my organization, these are some of the words that we are doing on the ground, to convince the farmers, the market women, that your digital rights are in fact inherent rights. They are your human rights. And when they are taken away, they take your right away. Mm-hmm. And we need to make sure that we communicate the message clearly to the indigenous people and local people in the small villages around the world as well. Thank you.
Well said. Do you think, Rebecca, you could add a question on whether shutdowns are a revenue generator for some of these telcos? Any comments on that?
I briefly mentioned that, and I think it's differing interests in different telcos, but there is a tendency to raise the security monster regarding messaging services, WhatsApp, you know, Viber in some countries and others, and that can feed the beast. So even if they don't specifically say we're supporting a shutdown, it supports a bunch of people in government who favoring that. So that's something that, you know, I agree with. It's a concern. I'll do a small plug. In fact, from Access, we're just putting out a discussion paper on OTT regulation and the fact that the telecom industry often brings that. So it's connected. I will give credit that there are many people in telcos who, even though they don't like OTT messaging services, still oppose shutdowns, but more can be done. And I'd give one flag that I think many telcos say, if we say anything, our licenses will be terminated or we'll be under pressure. And I do genuinely understand that because the telecom world is not a simple, clean world. But often their industry groups can do a lot more, can share information, can make statements. That's exactly what they're hired for. I know the GSMA has been doing some good fledgling work. I hope they do more. But particularly their local affiliates, their regional chapters, those guys can do much more, at least in putting out information, if not even taking part in legal challenges. So I'd flag that, because that is a vector, in fact, that all of us in our community should push them on. Use your industry chapters, use your affiliates to file, to put out information, and go to the regulator if required.
I have a question, actually, for the panel. I'm just curious, how do each of you explain the rise in the number of shutdowns? Is this, you know, at one point it was very, very rare and frequent. Now it seems to be 50, much more common, much more cavalier attitude towards shutting off internet services. Is there an explanation for why this is happening? Is it just region specific? It doesn't sound like it either. What do you say?
I'll take this one. I get this question quite a bit since maybe the Arab Spring of, actually the question is more, is it on the rise or is it, there's actually been times that I can't, you know, intellectually, honestly say that there's a straight line going up of every month there's more and more and more. There'd be periods of months that I wouldn't be aware. Maybe there was something, some localized blocks going on, but as far as like a national, you know, shutdown, I think even just a year ago, things have changed in the past year, but even just a year ago in discussion with a reporter, I would have to have a very nuanced answer of like what's happening in this space. Are things, in my mind at the time, that was that the Egypt style, pull the plug on everything, was probably a thing of the past, and now we've evolved into a new, more sophisticated way of this blocking particular services or throttling traffic. So it's really unclear, is it just bad connection, or, you know, it's not as obvious what's happening. I thought those would be, and that stuff probably still is gonna continue in the future. I didn't really think that, I thought maybe we were past the total blackout thing, and then we had, you know, several dozen Iraqi outages, Syrian, so in the last year there's been quite a bit, and then in Africa there's been quite a bit in the last year, so, but there's been some ups and downs, I think, and so it's not a straight line to me.
Well, in the case of Africa, well, in general, I think there is a global law when it comes to internet freedoms. I'm sorry to say it here, but there are lots of threats, and we'll talk about it during the 3 days. And more specifically, when it comes to Africa, one thing which is interesting is that we have to remember that it's a continent that was a bit apart from the rest of the world 10, 15 years ago, because very few people had a landline, which were very expensive, so it was difficult to interact with outside your country. And then suddenly you have the internet, and suddenly you have 2-3 mobile phones, and you can send videos in a matter of a second. And obviously for countries which, unfortunately, the continent has a lot of countries which are not used to openness and, you know, interacting with citizens and dealing with discontent, dissatisfaction in a human-friendly manner. It's a challenge for them. So I think it's a reaction that they have for now. Time for them to find a way. It's really a challenge. In my opinion, it's a challenge for these governments to find a way to settle, I mean, find a way to discuss with their citizens and deal with this this type of discontent, and the fact that you cannot hide anything anymore in the digital age, in the information age. And whenever you want to hide it, you'll have Snowden talking about the internet blackout in Cameroon. You'll have the State Department making a statement. You'll have the UN or the Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Expression saying it's wrong, or the Internet Society or whoever. And yes, it's a challenge for this country. So the main reason, I think, is that most countries were not used to that openness and that they need to adapt. It's a bit long.
Let's go, Rebecca, and then over.
Well, I hope our friends at the State Department will continue to be able to make statements on these things. But yeah, I mean, you know, part of it is that, you know, I mean, you've been tracking various forms of internet controls now for, 15 years, almost.
Aging.
This is due to the rise of the importance of the internet in the developing world in particular, where people are gaining access to the internet through smartphones, which wasn't the case back in the old days when it was just filtering going on. And clearly governments are learning from one another, and they're copying each other's practices. There's some knowledge sharing and in a less positive vein that certainly goes on, and policy copying and law, you know, sort of copying of laws and so on. So it's definitely, you know, time for sort of this is again why the whole kind of keep it on campaign is so important, because you do kind of need a global movement to push back and develop, you know, what's the model law look like? You know, what are best strategies to push back on?
And I was going to say, it's really that. It's particularly the mobile internet, and governments are tracking that. So it's the reality that the mobile internet is spread. People have connectivity in a way they've never seen it before. And it's no longer just the elites. It's everyone. And that's also telling. So like sometimes slightly racist term that Indian police use, which the British police used to use, is that, oh, if you're a regular person in India, you're a Tommy. You know, reference to like, you know, the regular rank and file of the British Armed Forces. And like what the Tommies read is what you should be concerned about, because they're the ones who really can cause issue. So I always find it interesting that when they do use illegal power to block the internet in India, the one they often cite to is something called Section 144 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, which is from the 19th century, which was used originally in the freedom movement to basically prevent more than 5 people congregating. That provision continued into independent India for a bunch of reasons, has stayed, although the Supreme Court has read it down sometimes and carefully kept it there. That same law is there in Myanmar as well, and all the other countries were part of, you know, British influence there. But it's that establishment power, and the fact that you haven't challenged the establishment on that previously, they're now applying that power for the internet. And they're saying, the mobile internet is everywhere, anyone can access it, it's really powerful, so we will try and restrict that. We won't shut down the entire internet, because that may affect other people, but also that would be too provocative. So we'll disrupt it temporarily for a couple of days or a week or do something like that. And because those powers are there, they're trying to apply them again in the internet age. And that same tension in our societies, that where people have not been able to prevent or control them in the past, they want to now bring it here. I would say, in fact, they're slightly more canny about it, because they know the internet's very personal to people. So they try and do temporary shutdowns, not keep it like fully off, because they also use it. But they do want to control it, they want to be able to disrupt you when they need to.
You know, you're talking about the normalization of this going on. I'm wondering if perhaps, you know, once you open the door to something like throttling, does that present another opportunity here, where it's kind of a slippery slope? Oh, if we can slow certain protocols or slow traffic down, maybe it's not much different to just shut it off in certain neighborhoods or jurisdictions for a certain period of time.
And I think that's where the application discussion is in particular, because very often for law enforcement in the developing world, the thing they say is we want to target messaging services. And that's where the slowdown point is really interesting. Now, it'll be a great conversation with many of the product managers with those companies, because they do a great amount of work in making it a very nimble application, so it's hard to slow down. But that's exactly the worry that I have as well, that they would try and bring those protocols and you don't know it's being shut. So short answer is, I think that's there. I think very often for them, for law enforcement, that's more a sophisticated argument, and they know if they engage on that, there'll be more scrutiny. So they've not done it yet, but if, and maybe we should give them that idea, but maybe that's something that's coming. That's one thing. On a separate note, I'm happy that many telecom regulators now in the developing world are being forced to confront net neutrality, because if you confront net neutrality, you have to talk about that discussion, and then sometimes you're bound by public discussion. So at least in India, I know that now they're bound by some oversight on that, but let's see.
Hi, my name is Dua, I'm from Tunisia. My question is to Rebecca. You mentioned that national security argument for internet shutdowns. Were you meaning that there's like times when internet shutdown needs to happen, or?
That's a good question. So just to clarify, I was really talking about justifications around reporting. So I'm not talking about national security justification for the shutdown itself, but more about transparency around who made the request or what the request was. You know, I can't think of a case at the moment off the top of my head where there would be a really great national security reason not to allow transparency. I'm not ruling out that maybe there is one for around transparency, you know, because you know there are a lot of debates. Different people have different views around sort of what granularity of transparency you should have about different types of government requests. But yeah, but that's different than you know, is there a national security argument to be made to shut down the internet? It's hard to think of one. And certainly, you know, UN Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Expression, David Kaye, has basically said there is none, so.
And, sorry, just, there's another question that I, when we talk about the argument of national security, the absence of a judiciary authority in that process. Yeah. It's crazy. Most of the times, the government just sends a fax or whatever, an order, and it's okay, we just shut down. Where is the judiciary authority that's supposed to evaluate whether it's necessary and proportionate and all the characteristics? So yes, that's a question I have.
Another question?
Hi, my name is Elsa Saadi. I'm from Gulf Center for Human Rights. We're also a part of the campaign. I'm just really curious to know how you actually reach out to people who don't have a precedent in their countries of shutdowns. And in fact, they're not really aware that it could happen to them at any time, at any point. So how would you reach out to these people who have not lived in such situations and who might actually face such situations? Plus, I'd also like to highlight that sometimes more people who have more capacity building skills and let's say knowledge know how to get out of this situation, but most of the people who are being affected are the people who don't know much about it and who are not on the forefront with the Keep It On campaign or with other campaigns or in the judiciary or et cetera. So how would you deal with such situations?
Great questions. Anybody want to take those?
I could just make a point. You know, there's a lot of people who live in countries where they think it's not a problem, where it actually is. Like in the United States, there's been some shutdown issues like in public transport systems and so on. Around incidents that have, you know, yeah, and so yeah, it's always a little more likely than you think it might be in a lot of places.
What about the circumvention side of the equation? Are there plans within this campaign to proselytize, instruct people on how to?
I think
emergency measures to.
Yes, since we are all aware that of the fact that it's something that could happen anywhere, really the key is anticipation. We've had a lot of experiences when we're just, oh my God, there is a shutdown. What do we do now? Wait, we need to call this one, then talk to telcos, and we're in the emergency. So it's very difficult to do advocacy with people who could on how to circumvent, although we do as well. I mean, Access is doing a great job with the helpline. But we've realized that it does not necessarily reach everyone. So I think really the anticipation is important and linked to this idea that of raising awareness of people even in places where we think it could be unlikely that a shutdown would occur. It's very important to talk to their media as well. In the case of Cameroon, that's what we really thought was important is to, well, the tweet of Edward Snowden was really helpful because it really helped everyone understand that. Yes, he's right. It could happen to me. And by doing this, we can, by anticipating on the narrative and also on the on how to circumvent and on reaching out to populations that are not member of the Kipinon or not take savvy or anything, I think probably we'll, I mean, more people will be aware of this, but we probably also need to reach out to other civil societies, I mean, which are not only linked to digital rights community, but also lawyers or other communities who have contacts with the citizens.
Or people in the medical profession.
Absolutely.
I mean, a number of groups have documented, you know, people's inability to contact medical services or hospitals' inability to access important information during shutdowns, and perhaps that might be.
And I was going to say that, you know, that's why the policy person in me always is wary about circumvention in this, because you don't want to focus just on that. You want to say you want to prevent it from happening. Here are communities engaging on this who might be able to even get around this, but you want to prevent it from happening there. And I think that's also the like real challenge, is articulating that, yes, some people might be able to get around the shutdowns. As you mentioned, they'll often be better off elite. But you want to focus that the majority of people can't, and that's important. And I'll give you an anecdote why. Someone challenged a state shutdown in India from the state of Gujarat. Very prosperous, the current prime minister's from there. They shut down the internet for several weeks, mobile internet. They challenged it in the state high court. The state high court said no. We will let it continue, or rather we won't rule it unconstitutional because people had connectivity through fixed broadband. Some people did. So it wasn't a full shutdown. That went to the Indian Supreme Court. The Chief Justice of India at that point of time declined to intervene, so he didn't rule in favor of it, but he didn't also accept the challenge. Basically on that point that some people had access. And that's the dangerous thing. Like, I know journalists who say that, oh, but we can transmit. And I say, yeah, because you have an OB van that's come with you. If independent reporters I know who are not part of the mainstream establishment, who are also a bit more critical, go in and they try to file on their mobile phone, they can't. So the cases I know where outside the national capital of Delhi, they shut down the internet in Haryana, adjoining state. They've had to commute back. The second they're able to cross into Delhi state boundaries, the network works, then they can file.
So can I just plug, the next session at 2:30 is on experiences of shutdowns and circumvention. So if you're interested in exploring that further, please come out. There was someone who had a question here. We have about 2 minutes.
2 minutes,
so,
okay, I was going to ask you that. Yeah.
I think that person may have left, so there was one back here.
Just while getting the question, I can certainly sympathize with this idea of not being able to anticipate when they're going to happen. From a research perspective, we made a strategic decision at Citizen Lab. We can't possibly, you know, cover every country in the world. Rob Ferris will appreciate what I'm talking about there, just in terms of resources. So we decided, let's focus on events and see, you know, if we can. But most of the time, you expect something to happen, it doesn't. And the ones that do happen, you don't expect.
Hi, my name is Vesna Manojlovic. I'm from RIPE NCC. And I have not a question, but like two comments and invitations. So we have the crowdsourced measurement network that actually can detect the internet shutdowns. It's called RIPE Atlas. And so we can share the data. It's all open and public. So if you're interested, we can talk about it later. And for the people who would like to help measuring it, I have these devices with me, so you can volunteer to host one in your country. Please see me in the breaks. I'll be here the whole RightsCon. Thank you.
Assuming there are no more questions, any final comments from the panels? Want to preview anything that's coming up other than what
Deji? I think Deji is the one previewing, but there are many, many other sessions.
Yes.
Pretty on the shutdown summit. I encourage people to look at that. Deji, anything else that you want to call out for the day?
Just related to that, our 24-hour free digital security helpline, we have people in the room here and at the conference, help@accessnow.org. If you are experiencing a shutdown or you're concerned about that, we also have a separate email, which is shutdowns@accessnow.org, and that helps us collect data to understand what's going on, how we can help circumvent.
That all goes to Gustav's inbox.
It all goes to Gustav. Gustav here is laying low, but is sort of he and Peter are the brains behind the operation, the technical side, and the policy side. Thanks.
Okay, so I want to thank everybody for this really informative panel and congratulate you all on the work that you're doing in this really important area. And thanks, everybody, for coming.